So welcome to the next talk of this session. It will be about Python in gravitational wave research communities. And ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our speaker, Elena Cuoco.
Thanks. Good morning, everybody. Thanks to be here for my talk of Python in gravitational wave communities. Before starting, something about me. I am a physicist working as a data scientist at the European Gravitational Observatory in Italy. I'm a member of LIGO-Virgo collaboration, and I'm also the scientific coordinator of a European project Graviton, which has the aim to train 14 PhD students in Europe. I am also a machine learning passionate, so during my free time I participated to Kaggle competition, and I am also a science outreach passionate. This is me while dancing with my colleague during an outreach event at Virgo site. Why gravitational waves? You have heard that this year we gave the announcement of the first detection of gravitational waves. A new era has just started. In September, we made the first detection of gravitational waves. In December, we made the second detection of gravitational waves. So I'm here to try to explain why gravitational waves in this event was so important. Spoiler alert, sorry, but this is a spoiler of the keynote talk of tomorrow, my colleague James, that is here. Some warnings about my talk. In 45 minutes, I will try to explain everything on gravitational waves, so it will be almost impossible. So if you have questions, I'm here during these days and also today. This talk is meant for beginners, but I can avoid to introduce technical details while explain everything. Why here at EuroPython? Because we used also Python to achieve these results. In everyday working activity in our labs, we use Python in control room, doing signal processing, controlling our system. I try to, while explaining what are gravitational waves, how we detect them, I try to point to all the Python usage we made in Virgo and LIGO, and for sure it is not an exhaustive list of the Python usage. So let's start. What is the challenge, first of all? What are the gravitational waves and how we discovered them? So in 1915, this guy that maybe you know, Albert Einstein, introduced the theory of general relativity. He said important things. He said that the geometry of space-time is linked to the content of mass and energy of the space-time. So there is this strict relation that is expressed in this beautiful formula that links the geometry to the mass, in some way, mass energy. So, just a little joke if you want to play with me. So I need some volunteer. Don't be afraid. You have only to keep in your head the space-time. Please, come here. So, come. I have the space-time, so, please, come on, I need another one, so keep it as flat as possible, so this is the space-time in some ways you can think, and in the absence of any mass, it is flat, but if you have a very massive body that is in the space-time, it becomes curved. This is what Einstein said. If there is a presence of a massive body in the space-time, it curves the space-time itself. But, I will try, this is an experiment, if there are also mass that moves in your flat space-time, you can see that, maybe you not, from they can see that, that there are little ripples that are created in the space-time that moves in the space-time itself. These are the gravitational waves. Thanks. And that's what we are trying for many years to detect. The research of a gravitational wave detection started many years ago. Einstein wrote this article just 100 years ago. The problem of the gravitational waves that they produce a very tiny effect in the space-time. So the challenge is to detect this small effect. But as side effect, the fact that they interact so little with the mass can help us in understanding much more about the universe itself, because they can bring information that otherwise we cannot access. So, since they are so small, so tiny, we should think to astrophysical phenomena. So that massive body that I show you should be very, very big. So we should think to star, very massive star. I show here the main source of gravitational waves that we expect from. There are the rotating neutron star, the so-called pulsar, that while rotating around its asymmetrically around axis can produce gravitational waves. There is the violent phenomena that are called the supernova, when there is an implosion of a big star, and during this phenomena it can produce very intensive gravitational waves. Then there are the event that we detected, that is the black hole colliding, the compact collision binary, and I will concentrate my talk around this phenomenon. And then we thought also to the existence of a gravitational wave background, the one that is remnant from the Big Bang. So this is a simulation of the phenomena that we detect. These are two black holes that are rotating one around the other, and while they rotate, they become closer and closer because they are losing energy, and at some point the gravitational attraction is so intense that they collide. And that was the event that we detected in September. So why we were so confident that the gravitational wave exists? Because we are looking for them for many years. Because in 1993, these two guys won the Nobel Prize because they prove in an indirect way the existence of gravitational waves. They observed for many years to a binary system, the energy lost by this binary system, and estimate the quantity of energy that can be lost as gravitational waves. And these red points are the measure they made, while the blue lines is the prediction. And as you can see, the fit is almost perfect. So we know they exist, and we try to detect them. I will skip the first experiment, and I will concentrate over the recent experiment. How we can detect them? We can use the effect that they made on free mass that they can hit while they passing through. So this is a simulation, obviously. And while a gravitational wave hit somebody, it can stretch in one direction and elongate in another direction. This is a schematic effect on a tennis ball. If we think to some test mass put around a circle, while they are invested by this gravitational wave, it can start oscillating. And we can detect this small difference in length above the length itself. And this is what we call the strain of the gravitational waves. The problem of this strain is that it is very, very small. It is the order of 10 to minus 31. Just to let you understand of which are the dimension we are talking of. If the diameter of a human hair is 10 to minus 5 meters, the diameter of an atom is 10 to minus 10 meters. The one of the nucleus is 10 to minus 14 meters. The diameter of a proton is 10 to minus 15 meters. And we are trying to detect a small displacement that is 1,000 of the dimension of the diameters of the a proton. So this was our challenge. And now, which tool we used to detect this small displacement? We used the Magel interferometers. We think to this schematic position of some test mass, and we try to detect this small displacement using this oscillation of the test mass, and take advantage of the phenomenon of the interference of the laser. I will explain better using a video that one of our colleagues produced. This is a laser that was sent in through a beam splitter. So the first mirror that it encounters is the device, the laser in two directions, the one that are the two perpendicular arms of our interferometers. This laser go back and forward. While the gravitational waves hit the interferometer, it starts moving the two test mass. So we can see light here, or don't see, following the movement of this mass. So this was the idea. We can detect this small movement by looking at the light that appears at the end of this interferometer. But this is a schematic view.
Now we add an extra mirror in both beams. In this configuration,
the experiment is much more complicated than the one that I show. Obviously, to have a better and better sensitivity, we want that this laser make many paths in what we call cavity, better fabric, però cavity. So the light became more intense, the path that the laser made is longer. So the sensitivity at the detection bench will be higher. Then there are further mirrors that are part of the optical setup that help us to clean as much as possible the laser itself, to aumente the to make higher the power inside the interferometer. And that, more or less, this is the how it works. But this is the ideal world. The real world is that we have a noise that is much more higher than what we are looking for. So we know that many other things that can move this mirror that are not gravitational waves, but are seismic noise, that are thermal noise, that are due also to the air that the laser can meet during its travel. So we should take care of reducing as much as possible the noise. We can do this from an experimental point of view, so while projecting our detector, or in when we analyze our data. So I will show how we do this. The first care that we put in reducing the noise was to reduce as much as possible the seismic noise. As you see, our Earth is continuously moving, so all these optics were shaken by the seismic noise. And we want that the mirror should be keep at rest as much as possible. So we used this instrument that we call a super attenuator. The mirror is hanged to this chain. And all the optics in Virgo, but also in LIGO detector, are suspended in such a way that it can be considered in the same place as much as possible. So we know that what we see is not seismic noise, at least at some frequency. One more thing that we made is to put all the optics in under vacuum, because we want that the laser go through the cleanest possible path. So all the optics were covered, put in a tank. This is the real, this is the tube, the Virgo tube. And we are here, we have one in Europe, one of the biggest vacuum experiment, under vacuum experiment, much more than the CERN. Other thing that we have cured is the thermal noise. We know that all the components, all the optical components can cause thermal noise because the molecule that compose our component can move due to the temperature, and this can cause thermal noise. So we take care of this building mirror, very special mirror. These are an example of the advanced Virgo mirror. These are made of a particular material. These are silica material. They are very heavy and very, very big because they have to beat and by the laser many times. And with this, we tried to keep under control the thermal noise. This I will show now how it looks like in reality Virgo. This is a video made by my colleague with a drone. This is Virgo, this is in Italy. This is close to Cascina. This is what we call the main building. All the optics, all the injection laser is here. These are the two arms of the interferometer, the 3 kilometers arms. At the end of this tube, you find the two end mirror, and the laser go through this tube, go back and forward, and then they recombine in the central building. Sorry. Okay, so let's come to the main topic of this talk, that is Python in gravitational wave communities. Why I'm here talking of Python? Because, as I said, we used Python in many, many fields of our research. As I said, Virgo and LIGO are very complex instruments. This is a schematic view of the optical scheme that I showed before, the two-end mirror, the input mirror, the injection laser, and we, as I said, there are have to control a lot of noise that can make worse our sensitivity. At the end, we came out with what we call a sensitivity curve. So we know how much we are sensitive to gravitational waves by looking at this curve. If we want to detect an event, this should be in some way higher than our noise. So we can do prediction, estimation of our noise, and see how much we are sensitive. One of the tools that we used, for example, is the simulation. We have some optical simulation to know how the optics behaves. This was written in Python. This is PyCat. I put everywhere the link that you can go there and have a look at. This is the first usage of Python. But as I said, we want to control as much as possible everything in our interferometer. So the mirror, we have to keep the interferometer locked, that is at its working point. So we don't use only what we call passive control of our optics, but also active control. So there are many things that are used in control room and are based on Python. This is a short list of what we use in Virgo. We started also to write a documentation of all this package, and many of these are used daily in our control room. So there are automation of the locking procedure that were done using Python. But now came to data analysis. How we can extract a signal from our noise, because this is the point. We build an instrument, we know that we can detect a gravitational wave using this instrument, but how we can make this? What is, first of all, a gravitational detection? We have noise. we have astrophysical signal, and we know that this signal that are time series, we have hidden a signal, and that is much more smaller than the noise itself. And we have to extract this. The astrophysical source that I showed at the beginning produce a different signal. The rotating neutron star produced what we call continuous waves. These are periodic signals. These are present continuously in our data with a given frequency. So this signal should be there for all the run that we made while acquiring data. This signal, if it's there, is there continuously. While there are other signals that we call transient signals, there are very short transient signals that are due to the supernova events. We have a lot of release of energy in very, very short times, the order of milliseconds. Then there are the collection binaries that are always transient because they start with this rotation one around the other and then collide. And so this can last from some milliseconds to some seconds. It depends on the mass of the phenomena. And then we have what we call broadband signal that can be due to the stochastic background. This is simply a noise in some way that should be of some way below our signal. So it is very difficult, So it is very difficult to detect. In the ideal world, we have noise and signal that are summed, and in ideal world, our noise is good, it's nice, it's a Gaussian, and it's a stationary. In this ideal world, exists an optimal filter to detect the signal. So a bit of formula. Obviously, I won't go through the extraction of this formula, but the idea is that with this characteristic, we know what will be the best way to extract the signal. So if this is the data that came out from our instrument, we have the noise and the hypothetical signal. We try to match our data with a template. We, for example, I'm talking of collection binaries. We know theoretically how it could be this signal, the waveform of the signal itself. So we try to match a template with our data, weighted by the power spectral density, by the noise. This is a formula that is derived in a perfect way from mathematics. What we can do? So if we have a signal, a template, and we do this match, we can find and say that we found a signal if this quantity is above a threshold. Maybe it's clear with this simulation. This is the signal that is hidden in the noise. And this is our template. This is moving along the data. While it encountered the real signal and it matched the exact waveform, we can see this peak. Okay, we detect a signal. So if the match is perfect, or almost perfect, we know that we have a trigger in some way in our data. And also this pipeline, in some way, was written in Python. This is a PyCBC. This is the documentation of our LIGO colleague, and all this code is in GitHub, so you can go there and have a look at the code itself. So the idea of this mechanism to detect the signal is to build a template bank. So we know what is the waveform that we are looking for, but we don't know the parameters of this waveform. The parameters are linked to the mass of the binaries, to the position, to the fact that the star maybe are spinning. So we have a very large parameter space that we have to span to find the exact template of our phenomena. So we can, in some way, simulate the signal to produce this template. And also this was done using Python in some way because we have a C library that we're embedding in Python, this is called PyLAL. And we simulate the waveform using this library. We estimate this important quantity, that is the signal-to-noise ratio. For some of you that are doing signal processing know what it is. It is the an estimate of how your signal is higher than with respect to your noise. You know how intense is your signal, give in some way this quantity, that is the amplitude of the signal itself weighted by the noise spectral density. Why I introduce this? Because when we build our template bank, we said, okay, we build a template bank taking account the fact that we don't want to lose much more than the 3% of its signal-to-noise ratio. So, for example, for the detection of the event in September, we end up with 250,000 waveforms. So you can imagine how many times this match filter was done to produce the real signal. And this is the parameter space that we can span using this number of waveforms. So till now we'll talk about the signal, the instrument, and the way in which we can extract the signal in the ideal world. But the detector noise is not so ideal as we want. It is not stationary. That means that it is not the same while passing the time. So each, after some minutes, it can change. It is not Gaussian, so it is the distribution of this data are not a perfect Gaussian distribution, and can be contaminated by the presence of many spurious events. There are many things that can mimic in some way gravitational waves, because as I said, the supernova could produce a gravitational wave. We don't know exactly the waveform, so it's simply a glitch that we can see in our data. So we should take care of cleaning as much as possible our noise before they try to detect something inside it. There are many packages that rely also on Python, which we used to do this procedure. GWPy, GWPy Soft, LaldeChar, PyLal, and PineApp, there are their algorithms that we use to clean the data. And this is important because what I show is the example in which we know the waveform, but what happens if the noise is not as ideal as we want, if we don't know anything of the signal itself. So we should use what we call a trigger generator that are generic. So we look for transient signal in our data that are simply find excess of signal in the data that can be due to different sources of noise or of signal. By the way, the first pipeline that triggered the signal in September was one of these generic tool. This is called the Coherent Wave Bars, and it's based on wavelet decomposition of the data. And this is how it looks like, that signal. So these different pipeline are important for noise characterization, because we use this pipeline, so generic one, just to find the different glitches that are in our data. This is what is called a glitch gram, so the number, the glitch that are present in our data. So many of these, you can think it are signal, but obviously they are noise, and we should identify each of them to be sure that our signal was not one of these. We are a network. We LIGO instrument detect the signal, but we are a network. There are the two LIGO in the USA, Virgo in Italy, GEO in Germany. There is CAGRA that is almost operating. There was approved LIGO India in the next year. But why we are a network? Because the gravitational wave detector are not as the standard telescope. You cannot point your detector in some direction of the space to look for some signal. If you want to know the source the position, the source position of your event, you need to do the triangulation of the results. So you can consider where the interferometer are, the traveling time that the wave, that the gravitational waves were detected in the different detector, and in this way you can, in some way, have information on the position of the source. This was in some way the error of the position in the sky for the event we detect, and to do this kind of localization in the sky, we use always Python some way. Here are some link where you can find this notebook and a tutorial to apply this estimation of the position. Why we are network? Because much more detector are, much more will be the precision with, of the estimation of the position of the source. So when the also Virgo, Kagra will be operating, this big area can become this small area in the sky. That's why it is important to be a network. So come to the event. The gravitational wave have been detected. So it for many years, it seems almost impossible, or also for people that are working in this field. And I'm sure that many of us, when have the alert, no one believe that was a real event, because we were very surprised by the fact that it was so beautiful, as I will show you. It is almost perfect to the prediction. So we have this guest star of 14 September, but also in December, during the first scientific run of LIGO, there was another event that were detected, always black hole colliding. This is the event. In 3 minutes, after the data acquisition, we have the alert. There was an email that go around and say, okay, there is a strange event in our data. Please have a look at the data better. And it starts all the procedure that let us give the announcement in February. So these are the waveform of the two of the event seen in the two different detectors in Hanford and Livingston. This is how it looks like in time domain. The line, continuous line that is superimposed is the prediction, the template that matches at best this signal. So as you can see, it's almost perfect. And I want to show you, this is the famous chirp sound. I don't know if you can hear. No, there is no sound, wait. We call this kind of signal chirp just for this sound that you can hear, because there is this frequency that is became higher and higher during the time that produced this beautiful sound for our. The one that we detected in December was a bit different, say always two black holes, but with a smaller mass, so it was detected directly by a pipeline that is based on magic filtering, and the waveform is always the same, this frequency that changes in time with this big peak at the end of the phenomena. So this is are a few numbers about the detection. So the first event has a very big signal-to-noise ratio. That was why it was so evident in our data. The second event has a smaller signal-to-noise ratio. These are the distance, so 1.3 billion of light years and 1.44 billion light years. And the solar mass, as you can see, are different. For the one, they are very, very big, so these are very compact black hole, 36 and 29. For the second event, 14 and 7. There was also another event that was considered candidate event during October, but the statistics was not so good to make us claim another detection. So, coming to my personal experience working in this field, I'm a signal processing researcher, so I'm a data analyst, and I work as mainly as for noise characterization. So I'm one of the persons that clean the data before the detection. In Virgo, we developed this library that is a noise analysis package. It's a C++ library that we're embedding in Python using Swig. And now we have this PineApp generic noise analysis toolkit. I developed this event trigger generator that it was based on the wavelet that can be used just to detect noise. And in the last period, also trying to using machine learning tool to classify the noise signal. This is the environment in which we work, using Python, scikit-learn, scipy-numpy, and you know all of this. Just to show what we did, these are the typical output of our detector. So these are the data came out from the detector. These are the same data after the cleaning, the whitening, the so-called whitening. And you can see that there are these two peaks here that in time frequency appear in this way. So the idea is to have a look to this kind of waveform and classify the signal, the noise signal in some way. And we did this using machine learning technique that separate the signal in different class, just trying to fit in different way the waveform of the signal. So, in the abstract, I said that we can have a look to the data. There are LIGO produced this LIGO Open Science Center. You can go there. This is the link. You can download the LIGO data. You can play with this LIGO data. There are beautiful tutorial. Now there are two beautiful tutorials because they did the same with the second event, where there are some signal processing technique well described there, and you can play and see how it works. Maybe we can try now. I prepared a short version of this. So, hoping it, it works. I download the data on my PC. So you can recognize there many of the Python package that maybe all of you use. And plus some signal library of SciPy that were used to prepare filter. The data were prepared in the format HDF. While in Virgo and LIGO we use a different format to save the data that are in what we call frame data. I've been time. And you can also load the simulation waveform, the waveform that it was simulated. You can have a look at the data. This is how it looks like your data. In this, these are the some seconds of data around the event. So in this data, the two detectors, two different detectors, in somewhere you see were hidden the event. So you can see that it is impossible to identify some events here. But if you use some signal processing technique, for example, the so-called whitening. What is the whitening? These are the data, the power spectral density of the data that is similar to the sensitivity curve that I showed at the beginning. We call this noise. So our noise is not flat, it's full of features, full of lines that are due to many sources of noise, can be due to the 60 hertz power in LIGO and 50 hertz power in Virgo, because in Italy there are many lines that are due to the thermal noise, the movement of the wire that are suspended, the mirror. So some of these lines are well identified, but if we estimate this power spectra density and apply the wiring, that is the inverse procedure of this power spectral density. We divide in some way the data by this quantity. Just do. And then plot the whitened data. This is our event. So just simply whitening your data without doing strange things, you can identify your event. These are the two strains, two different detector, that, and in black there is the simulated matched waveform, the one that triggered. So the same if you look at in the time frequency domain. Sorry, I don't know if how many of you know these terms. These are how it looks like the time frequency plot. The signal was there, but you cannot see without do anything to your data. But if you apply again the whitening and you produce the same plot, here it is, your signal. So maybe, I don't know if it is so evident also for you, but yellow. Okay, this is the so-called chirp in your data. So, I'm also almost ended. The data are now also on Kaggle. I don't know if some of you will play on this platform. So there is some portion of this data. There are some scripts that you can use directly there without downloading the data. If you want to create your Python script or in the script language that you prefer, you can play there. And that's it. So.
So. We might have time for just one question, one short question before lunch. We have one.
The question, basically question is, what is the gravitational wave on a physical level? That's it.
What is the relation?
Gravitational wave at the physical level.
Sorry,
a gravitational wave at the physical level. I think at the beginning of the...
Yeah, the physical level, okay, maybe, I don't know if you missed the first part of the talk. I show what are a gravitational wave. It is a tiny oscillation of the space-time. So your space-time in some way is moving. While I also now I'm producing gravitational waves because I'm a mass, I'm moving, and while I'm moving, I'm not symmetric because you need also that your mass are asymmetric while moving. And this can perturb your space-time. It's any more flat, but produce this small oscillation on your space-time itself that propagate through all the space-time that can reach the Earth or your or yourself.
Okay, I have one question, very quick. Is it true that the first event was detected when they were basically still testing the...
Yeah, this is true.
So it was not operational?
No, it was operational. It was during what we call engineering runs. Before the starting of scientific runs, usually there is a period of some days before that we use to test that everything is working. So we acquire data, but we officially are not in science mode, what we call science mode. But it was during, everything was running as it was in science run, because the pipeline were under test, and we saw this.
So basically, you were expecting to see the first event in 1 year, probably, and you get it before you started.
Yeah, no, we expect, to be honest, we expect that with the LIGO sensitivity, it was probably that we detect an event this year, but not so fast as we did. It was really unexpected for us.
Okay, thank you very much again.
Thanks.